All right, GTO Podcast Episode 9. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Davis.
Sam Walker.
And we have a special guest today.
You can just call me Will.
Special in the short bus kind of way.
And I heard
That's offensive. Heard
you've been talking mess about me. You got something to say?
I'm talking mess about both of you. It's just you weren't here for it.
All right, come on.
He wasn't talking mess about me. I was there.
Lay it on me.
Nah.
What?
Thick and wet.
Let's just let it come. Let's cross that bridge when we come to it.
Let it come.
All right. We got a Facebook that we don't use. We got a Twitter that we use sometimes. We upload videos sometimes.
Now we use the Facebook as much as we use the Twitter.
And go check those things out, because we used them, I swear. And first, let's talk about our special guest. He's very special. His name is?
Will.
All right. And what do you like, sir?
Well, if you look at the docket that we made.
What do you like, Will?
No.
I like video games. I like comics. I like politics, because I'm a nerd.
All right. That's all you had to say. That's all you had to say.
So good.
God. All right. So I read a little thing that you went to West Point. Very special. What are you going there for?
It was supposed to be for training, and while I did definitely get a lot of training, I also had to deal with a lot of high school level drama, which you wouldn't expect. Well, no, which you could kind of expect to find in a college.
How so?
It's so regimented there. Like, you know, in regular college, you get quite a bit of freedom. It's like you have to do your own laundry. You have to show up to class on your own time. And then when you do ROTC, you have to do training around your own class schedule.
Alright. Well,
there's a lot more latitude with what you're able to do, what you can focus your energies on. West Point, you don't really get that. At least in my limited experience in dealing with people there. You don't really get that. It's like your class schedule is virtually handpicked for you by the administration, and you have to show up. You have to complete certain numbers of duties in addition to all of your classwork, and you're expected to abide by a certain code of behaviors. And it's regimented like a very badly run private school. It made for a lot of interesting interactions with people.
So did you enjoy your time there, or
no? I met a lot of good people, and I definitely did get a lot out of some of the training that I did, so I'm glad I went, but I didn't enjoy it. And keep in mind, I mean, a couple weeks before going to this, I was doing training with my National Guard unit here in Louisiana, and that was a blast. That was some of the most fun I've ever had during summer, and to go from that to immediately West Point and everything that I experienced there, it was kind of a letdown.
So I really don't know exactly what you're training for. What is exactly your role that you're looking forward to?
Well, in my National Guard unit, since I'm an ROTC cadet and they don't really have like a specific job for us, I mostly just show up to fill in minor leadership roles where they need it. So like making sure people get to where they need to be, keeping accountability of people in gear to make sure that no things are lost. And training with them, it's a combat engineer unit, so trained to blow stuff up.
All right.
Like take C4 to a door, or take a shotgun to door hinges, kick down the door, and clear a room. Like that. That was the majority of the training we did. And then at West Point, it was kind of a much more generalized general infantry training. So it was just like, this is how you patrol through the woods. This is what it means to set up a patrol base, which is like a little temporary base that you have to make when you're going through enemy territory. Just small things like that. They also had what they called branch days, because you know how they're like the five branches of the service.
I don't
Army,
know. But
Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard.
Oh, I know. Okay.
Yep, that's all five. So you have them. Well, then within each of those branches, there are more branches. So like in the Army, you have general infantry, you have armor, which is like tanks, and then you have aviation, which is helicopters, artillery, so on and so forth. So they had branch days where they would teach us about individual branches of the Army. So those were pretty fun. They had an engineer day where they were teaching the cadets a lot of the same things that I already learned with my unit. There's a tank day. That was awesome. That was by far the best experience I've ever had in any military.
You got to be in a tank?
Got to be in a fake tank. Oh. But it's like they like built an exact replica of the inside of an M1A1 Abrams. And then they just let us control it for like 20 minutes. And I got to be a tank commander, meaning I got to tell everyone in the tank what to do and like how to, and got to control how we fought. I was terrible at it, but it was fun. We lasted maybe 10 minutes before we died.
Well, did you actually get to handle any C4 in your training, or?
Yeah.
Oh. You had to blow stuff up?
Yeah.
You had to shoot stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, man, that's so cool. How was the recoil?
Not really. Not when you... I mean, for me at least, I didn't have as much patience for a lot of the BS that I had to put up with at West Point at least. So I kind of grew tired of it pretty quickly.
So blowing up stuff wasn't fun?
Not really, no. It kind of got boring after a while because, I don't know, the overall atmosphere and culture of West Point kind of like took a lot out of me in terms of patience and my morale.
It's been, how long you been doing this training?
I was training at West Point for 4 weeks, and I trained with my guard unit for 2 weeks.
So it's been 6 weeks, and you already a jaded soldier?
No, I'm not. I wouldn't consider myself a full-on soldier yet, but...
Wow, you're not even there yet, and you're jaded.
I'm a soldier in training. I'm a warrior apprentice, as they say in the cadet creed.
Well, I respect you, even though you're not officially a soldier yet. I do respect your... that's all I gotta say. I really respect that. You got anything else to tell about your experience?
Yeah, don't go to West Point. You know school's bad when the majority of the student population that you have to deal with keeps on telling you, it's like, yeah, I definitely don't want to be here.
So how's this different from any other, like, military college?
No, apparently all the military colleges are like that. And then apparently the military college at Virginia, I think it's Virginia Military Academy or whatever, they're worse because you have to pay to go there. Because, like, with West Point, at the very least, your school is paid for. Like, you get in, you do the training, and you get the education, but it's all paid for, and then you get active duty once you graduate. With Virginia Military Academy, the way it apparently works is that you have to pay to get all of that. You have to pay to be treated like crap and get a rather interesting military and civilian education.
Why? Was it your choice to go to West Point, or were you sent there?
So, the story about my summer training experience is a little different from a lot of people. Because apparently a lot of ROTC cadets who went there, it was like they had to compete for it, or some of them, they were just told that's where they were going to go. But for me, the way it worked out is that I was already going to do some internship work in DC this summer. That's what I was hoping to do. And it just didn't work out because money was tight. And so I walked in to my senior military instructor's office, and I was just like, "Hey, Master Sergeant, can I get some summer training? Like, do you have anything for me?" And he's like, "We got CFT. You want to go to that?" And I was like, "Cool. What's that?" And he's like, "Well, you get to go to West Point, do some training with them." I was like, "Cool. What do I get to do at West Point?" I was like, "Well, you get to go to West Point." So, there was, like, little to no information on what we would actually be doing there. Like, even online and even in the informational packets.
So, everyone in the military, like, in that circle already knows it has a bad reputation, I guess? Is that what you're trying to tell me?
You mean West Point?
Yeah, West Point has a bad reputation.
Military academies tend to have a pretty negative reputation with a lot of lower enlisted personnel. Because it's seen as being kind of, like, an elitist institution. Not to mention a lot of people have negative experience with West Point officers, like officers who graduated from there.
I guess it would make sense to have an elitist personality when there's literally objective ranks that everyone has.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a little bit different when you're considering like the types of officers that come out of the different ways you can be commissioned. And, I mean, this is a huge generalization because I know there are a lot of good and a lot of bad officers from all walks of life. But it's like you have three ways, generally, to become an officer. Which would be military academies, like West Point. Then, the big criticism is that a lot of them come from a very elitist background or, like, a very, how would you say, kind of like high and mighty, smarter than you, mm-hmm. like they have the college education, but they also have the quote-unquote military training that somehow makes them more qualified than some of the soldiers that they end up leading, at least in their minds.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get officer candidate school, which is where a lot of enlisted personnel go when they want to become officers. For them, it's like after they become officers, they're competent, but they kind of want to pretend that they're still an enlisted person. They want to pretend that they're still an NCO or whatever, so they kind of forget what their job is. And with ROTC people like me, it's kind of like you kind of get a funny little hit or miss scenario where it's like sometimes you just get that great guy who just wants to learn to do everything right, and other times you just get a total asswipe who doesn't actually care about what he's doing, just kind of does it as like a box to check off before he goes to a job in the civilian world.
All right. Well, my final question on the subject: where are you going from here?
I'm gonna begin. If you walk throughout the house, actually, you'll see all my crap strewn all over the place, all my gear.
He's
right
moving
behind you.
Back to college.
Well, I'm moving into an apartment that's close to college, and then I'm gonna. Well,
yeah.
A little different than living in a dorm.
They didn't say you were living in a dorm, but anyway.
Yeah.
What is that college?
Oh, I go to a college at Loyola University. Oh,
all right.
Here in New Orleans. But my ROTC battalion is all contracted out of Tulane. Because Tulane's like right there. For those of you who don't know, Loyola is a very small Jesuit college here in New Orleans that's surrounded on two sides by Tulane University.
It's just a small college surrounded by a bigger college, and they're both really expensive. So.
Yeah, they are. Hence, ROTC, tuition, scholarship.
Yeah.
Well, I never talked to a person that ever been in any type of military training. I'm related to a couple of former soldiers, but that's pretty cool to talk to one every now and then.
Yeah.
Anyway, I really appreciate what you're working towards. Anyway,
you
want to talk about some comic books? I heard you're interested
always.
In that.
Always.
Well, tell me what you got.
All right. Well, first up, DC Rebirth. Sam, do you want to give the rundown on that?
You've always actually read it.
Yeah, true. So, as we all know, with the New 52 kind of got wrapped up with the death of Superman and the Darkseid War.
Totally.
to save a lot of spoilers, in case I didn't already spoil anything with the death of Superman.
Superman dies all the time. That's really not a spoiler.
Yeah, I know, but someone's going to be butthurt about it.
Our fans don't read.
I was just about to start reading,
wow,
man.
Insulting
you spoiled
your,
it for our co-host.
Insulting your fan base when you only have like 12 subscribers.
Nah,
good job, guys. Good job. In any event, I'm not going to worry too much about the story because you can easily find that out for yourself. I will talk about like these three.
It's just another reboot.
It's not even
another universe rebirth.
Except it's not a full reboot, because they're still continuing stories from New 52.
It's a soft reboot.
Yeah.
People are getting their lives back.
Yeah, because the whole argument being made in the very first DC Justice League rebirth that Flash was pointing out is that somebody changed the timeline. Somebody took 10 years or so away from the DC universe, and that screwed up a lot of people's relationships, origin stories, personalities, and even some of their powers, if I remember correctly. Who was it? Wasn't that the new female Green Lantern, Cruz?
I don't know.
Fairly certain that it had something to do with her. Can't remember. In any event, probably my favorite thing to come out of DC Rebirth, and the thing that I want to ask you guys about, your thoughts, have either of you read Watchmen? Either
yes.
Either the full proper comic or the Before Watchmen series?
Nope.
Yep.
You uncultured swine.
All right.
Just move on.
So at the end of the first issue, there's a huge hint dropped that the Watchmen universe, which has long been completely separate from the generic DC continuity, or the proper DC continuity, is now becoming a part of it. Because the person who took those 10 years away from the DC universe is actually a character from Watchmen. You ever heard of Dr. Manhattan, Mark?
No. That's a Watchmen character, right?
Yep.
It's the guy with the...
He's the blue guy.
The guy with the blue balls?
Yeah.
Except right. He doesn't actually have balls, if I remember right.
Didn't they make a joke about that in the movie?
Yeah.
Alright, that's
well,
the only
I mean,
scene I watched. I'm pretty sure.
He's human. Or he's a...
Well,
he's
humanoid. well, humanoid. He himself already talks about how he detaches himself from human affairs and his human identity.
And yet he still bangs his wife.
Except only to pleasure her. And you gotta remember, the guy is...
Still, it's kind of hard to stay attached when you're, you know, bumping uglies, knocking boots, making babies.
What a nice guy. He's having sex for the other person's enjoyment. There's no one who does that.
Yeah.
We should all be like Dr. Manhattan.
That totally went a different direction than I thought.
And everyone would be happy on this earth.
Hmm?
Everyone would be happy if everyone else were just giving up their lives for other people's happiness.
Yeah.
But it's so weird, because for Dr. Manhattan to pleasure someone...
Okay, why are we talking about his sex life now?
Because y'all are talking about how he's like trying to pleasure someone, but at the same time, you gotta keep in mind, his whole character is based around acting out the timeline. The timeline of every universe ever.
Do we have to remember that? Or can we just
Because you gotta think, is he actually having sex with her to pleasure her, or is he doing it because that's just part of the timeline? That's just
why
how the story's going.
Why can't it be both?
Because
intersectionality is real, though.
I don't
understand. Yes, but this has nothing to do with intersectionality and compounding identities when you're talking about a guy who experiences every reality simultaneously.
What?
Okay.
He exists as a continuous space in every single reality, which means the DC universe, technically the Marvel universe, our universe, and the Watchmen universe. So, in every universe, wherever something exists, he, in one way, shape, or form, at the very least, exists there as well and knows its timeline.
All right, what's his power, though?
That's his power.
What a lame power.
He does,
what do you mean?
He can also manipulate size and...
He can manipulate atoms.
Multiple, yeah, atoms.
All right, that's...
He is ostensibly Alan Moore's personification of God.
Sure.
All right.
Moving on.
Up it.
So what's the point? It's a reboot. That's it. All right.
Yeah, it's a soft reboot.
Yeah, very soft reboot.
What does that mean, though?
It kind of means
it
that,
doesn't
like,
reset. It doesn't reset everything, like back to zero.
Mm-hmm.
It just moves it back to a point when it last moves it back to the point where it last worked, where everyone agreed it last worked properly.
So when it
with
takes all the dead people back to life,
not necessarily.
Yeah, in some cases,
it's kind of a hard thing to say. It's like there was the era of New 52, where you know there were 52 universes, 52 Earths.
Sure.
And everybody.
Yeah.
So there were a lot of changes to characters made from the last comic continuity that was going on in DC at that time. Some of those changes were good, like they made Aquaman cool again, and like actually made him an effectual character in the DC universe.
Aquaman's been cool this whole time. You're just doing it wrong.
No, it was the writers doing it wrong.
But I got a question.
I just experienced it.
The point of a reboot, right, is to right the wrong. So what went wrong in the last continuity?
Well, they basically Zack Snydered the whole thing and made everyone dark and broody and annoying.
Mm.
They also really simplified a lot of people's origins.
I'm going to boil down DC Rebirth to one thing. This is what Jeff Johns says.
Jeff Johns, the creative director of everything DC now.
Not necessarily.
Yeah,
no,
he's
just
head of
DC
Entertainment. He was just made
yeah,
head
not
of
DC Comics.
Yeah, but he's head of DC Entertainment now, which encompasses
like
the
movies and stuff. Yes, it does encompass. Anyway, it's beside the point. It's to instill hope, and there's another word he said. Just hope and
wasn't it levity?
Sure.
Basically, the New 52 was all dark and heavy, and Geoff Johns wanted to use Rebirth as a way
yes,
to say, make it fun again, make DC fun again.
Hmm.
Instead of make DC great again.
Alright.
Had to make the joke.
We're going to make America great again.
Gonna make DC fun again.
Okay.
Gonna have a Superman that
okay.
smiles.
Yeah, we... Moving on.
So.
Something. Don't.
Oh, something funny about, so, you know about the Bat family in DC Comics? Like, Batman and all of his friends?
No. Wait. Lay it on me.
There's Batman, there's Robin, there's Red Robin, Nightwing,
oh, yeah. mm-hmm.
Red Hood and the Outlaws, Batgirl, Batwoman, and...
Red Hood and the Outlaws aren't really part of the Bat family, though.
Red Hood's part of the Bat family.
Yeah, but the Outlaws aren't.
Yeah, but when you have Red Hood, you kind of have to have the Outlaws.
Not exactly. Well, now you do.
Yeah. So, they have a new member of the Bat family that I thought was a very quirky and yet somehow befitting addition, Clayface. Clayface is joining the Bat family.
Yeah. I told you this.
No, you didn't.
Yeah, I did.
I think I would have remembered something that ridiculous.
I said,
hey,
All-Star Batman. You said no. And I'm like, but Clayface is working with the Bat family. And you said, what?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah. For those of you who don't know, All-Star Batman's my least favorite iteration.
Nobody knows that because nobody...
Nobody follows me.
Nobody follows you.
It sucks. Don't read it.
It's up to you. Okay.
Are we done with the comic books
talk
stuff?
We talk about movies in general.
Oh man!
Do you want to talk?
Go ahead, man. Go ahead. No, no. I mean, Will, you obviously came here to talk about that, so I'm gonna be your advocate. You go on.
This can be another thing.
Yeah. Give me some input, guys.
Sam, you want to talk about something? You want to talk about some bitch on YouTube or something? So.
Whoa. Okay.
Calm down, buddy.
Let's go to the fan audio. Last week, we asked you a question. Asked you to send in recordings of your biggest moment.
Did we ask it? Oh, yeah, we did ask that question. All right, say it. It's from Henry.
This is from your boy, Skinny Henry, Jimi Hendrix.
What?
Plate.
What kind of a name is that?
Mark, hey, Sam. So my favorite moment, my greatest moment, the one that made me feel really, really good, was when I asked my girlfriend out. When she said yes, I just felt amazing. Just amazing. Well,
nerd.
I'll talk to you guys when summer ends. Mark, we need to play some Smash Bros. Sometime. And Sam, I look forward to being on the podcast sometime. Talk to you in a bit.
All right. Thank you, Henry.
That's your boy.
That greatest moment blows mine out the water, but mine was hardest to do.
The only thing getting blown.
Oh, yeah.
Of my expectations. I didn't realize Henry could get a girl. Jeez, y'all are so disgusting.
And I'll take up that Smash challenge. So, last week you did talk about you're going to go into a Smash tournament at your church.
Yes. I ended up... Well...
Did you win for Jesus?
No. Because
he won for Satan.
We did a two-stock thing, which isn't that good, because, you die, like, immediately. And a couple people were just really good, and it was, the bottom two people would always switch out, but it was always the same two bottom people.
Yeah, because...
And then eventually, people just... You weren't even there.
I know, but I know what...
But it was, a tournament, or...?
It was supposed to be a tournament, but then it just evolved into four guys playing Smash while everyone else was playing Pokemon Go. Because Pokestop is in our church.
Is that church a couple of blocks away from here? That big...
No,
brown?
No. Mid-City Theater. So I dropped a lure, and I'm like, well, I'm going to be sitting here for, the next 5 hours. Might as well have some fun.
Wow. You must be, super leveled up now.
No.
What's your level?
It's 12.
Oh, it's more than me.
Because I kept running out of Pokeballs. I did catch a couple big ones. I got a Sea King, a Slowbro, and a Drowsy. Mm-hmm. And then a bunch of Magikarps. But not enough to level to evolve.
Yeah.
To Gyarados.
So about that YouTuber.
Okay, it's not...
What's her name? Marina Joyce?
Marina Joyce. So, this... isn't where I wanted to go at first, because it's kind of sad. But as a YouTuber, she's a vlogger in, I want to say Britain. Some in a European country. About 6 months ago, her videos became a little different in quality. Or her fans thought they were different. She seemed a bit more absent-minded. She had mysterious bruises all over her body. There were guns in the backgrounds of some of her videos. And people were like, okay, so she's obviously being abused.
How's that obvious?
I don't know.
There could be a multitude of things. She could... may want you to think that. I mean, come on. If she was getting abused...
I want you to think that?
People do a lot of things
stunt.
For a... Yeah.
Publicity stunt. But it wasn't. Her fans just blew it out of proportion. And she was like, I'm so glad they care about me, but this isn't the problem. The bruises came from a fall in the forest because I like to go hiking.
Probably did drugs. That's why you're absent-minded.
She says she doesn't do drugs because it would be an offense to her fans.
Right.
She seems more absent-minded because she's a Christian now. So her words, she's like, I put myself on a religious quest because I'm Christian now. And then 3 minutes later in the same interview, she's like, I'm Buddhist. Will, stop. Stop. It's distracting.
All right. Go. So...
So it's just, this whole situation's kind of messed up. She's been interviewed a couple times. One by Philip DeFranco. So go check that out.
Don't waste your time.
Go
check
that out if you care. Mark's just being a...
This person is trash. Why are we supporting this person?
Because he's not trash. He's
I'm not talking about. I'm not talking about. Talking about this girl.
We're not supporting the girl.
Why are we talking about this? This is more YouTube drama that's useless and doesn't.
It's not YouTube drama. This is legitimate things. Like she could have been in actual. She could have been in actual trouble.
Add that to a list of other people that are in actual trouble, like whole countries.
Okay, Mark. Whatever. So she's been confirmed safe and fine, so it sounds like it's all over. But it was scary for the YouTubers that
actually
cared.
How was it scary?
It was scary for the YouTubers that actually cared, because it...
What?
Mark's the wrong person to talk about this kind of thing.
I just don't see... Oh my god. Whatever.
It's a member of the YouTube community who might be being targeted by someone, or just being abused.
It's a member of our community. If we will... If this happened, like, during VidCon, like, if we were at VidCon... And then we were out late one night, and we got, like, kidnapped or something.
That has nothing to do with VidCon, though.
I'm saying, if we get targeted because of where we are, or what we are, what we do, then it is a problem. That might not be what her thing is, but if she were being targeted because she was a YouTuber, then it would be our problem,
but
too.
But when she has said something, though, if she was getting targeted...
If you're being abused, you can't just say, hey guys, I'm getting abused, please help. Because you're afraid of what will happen if you speak out.
That makes sense if you like. She has thousands of people following her at this point, like a million or something.
600,000.
I thought she got like a bunch more subscribers because of this.
Yeah, she was at like 60, and I think she's at 600 now.
All right, whatever then. You have people that actually care about your life, compared to like the regular average person that no one's following them, so their voice still unheard. You can actually do something about it. I think more than the average person.
No, but you still can't. You can't expect somebody in that kind of situation to A, be thinking that clearly, if assuming that we were in a scenario where she was actually being abused or held captive or whatever. But also, you can't just expect somebody in that kind of state of mind to actually have the competence to do that, even if they did think of it.
Yeah, we don't know what was going through her head, what was going through her family's, her friends. People were just all over the place saying she was on drugs, saying she wasn't, saying she was in trouble, saying she wasn't in trouble. But the whole thing's over. It's done. She's safe. The police have checked out her house. It's all fine. It's over. We're happy. People are safe.
So what was the thing you're talking about, Christianity and being a Buddhist or whatever?
She said that that's why it sounded like her videos changed, was because she's now a Christian. And then she said she was Buddhist. And I honestly don't.
I mean,
I don't know which one.
Keep in mind with the fact that, aside from like the real religious Zen Buddhists, generally Buddhism's just treated like a philosophy. People can be Buddhist and still have other religious faiths.
Yeah.
If you stick with just the,
you can. I mean,
philosophy.
Technically, every religion is considered open if you just adopt. I'm not saying you can identify.
Mark and I both are just like.
If y'all would let me finish.
Calm down. Yo, is he interrupting people?
Shout out to all them Christian Jews out there.
I'm saying if you adopt... What you're saying is adopting Buddhist beliefs, right? While also being Christian?
Yeah, the philosophy.
So if you adopt some Christian philosophies, like be a good person, if you follow the Ten Commandments but you don't identify as a Christian, that's basically the same thing.
Man, that's a great point. This story was pointless. Let's move on to something that does matter. Did you know that the NBA did something hypocritical?
Not at all.
So says the NC state representative. You know how the All-Star game got moved from, what's that city, Charlotte?
Yeah.
Because of
HB2.
Yeah. Can you explain that law to us, to everyone, please?
People that identify as a different gender from what they were born as have to go into the bathroom that they were born as. So if you're a male, if you were born male but identify as female, you have to go to the male bathroom. If you were born female but you identify as male, you have to go to the female bathroom. If you're born female and you identify as whatever you want, whenever you want, you still have to go to the female bathroom. And a lot of people are uncomfortable with that because that's not where they are mentally or physically in some cases.
So because of that, the NBA moved the All-Star game from that state to whatever, that doesn't matter, but...
Here.
It's in New Orleans again?
That's what it sounds like.
Oh, buy me some tickets, we're all going, right?
I'm not buying any tickets. I'm ready to like no, three pallet, two, one pallet game.
I want to get some nosebleed seats anyway.
Yeah.
The thing was, the NBA in general got called up because they're still working with China, and China, the example that was pulled up to say that they're hypocrites is that China's government allegedly is harvesting organs of minor circles. That's a true fact.
Yep.
All right, so
that's a little different though than. Like, it's harder to pull out of working with China entirely than it is to move a single game from a single city.
Yeah, and that's kind of, like, brings all the point down, but that's basically what it is. Do y'all think that's, like, a valid argument to say the NBA is hypocritical?
It's a tad hypocritical, but it's not something they can really control.
I would tend to agree with that. We're in a very large, interconnected world where so many people are connected to so many other different people. It's kind of hard for especially larger organizations like the NBA to not be kind of, I guess, pulled into slightly less than veritable dealings with other people in other countries. Not saying that's right, not trying to justify it, just saying that it's one of those things where you can't try to decry someone for trying to do what they believe is right, even when they're doing something else that we can all, I think, agree is probably not as upstanding as we'd want them to be.
All right, but
you can't expect everyone to be an idealist all the time, because otherwise you get nowhere.
Well, my problem is not the hypocrisy, but the taking the All-Star game out in the first place. You're making a stand for just some random law that you didn't care for like any time before this.
That's because it just got passed.
I know, but the stigma is still there, and that law in my eyes. It changes almost nothing. It's a very marginal amount of people that have that problem. I'll be willing to say very confidently that's a very small.
Aren't you the same one that said there weren't that many gay people in like our first episode?
Yeah, that's
there
true.
There are a lot of them.
I mean, you take 6% of like 300,000. Yeah, that's a lot of people, but it's still 6%.
That's
a lot more than you're. Sounds like you're saying there are.
What?
You're saying it's a small amount of the population, but
you're still talking about thousands of people. In that one example of 300,000. And we're talking about millions of people.
Millions of people in what?
You can't. Millions of people in the United States.
Well, yeah, that's what I mean.
And around the world.
Like 300 million people. Whatever the population of America is and what the world is, take 6% of that. But
it's probably not even 6%. That's just what the people that were polled. There are probably more that weren't.
That either don't identify with that or just.
No, people that didn't respond or couldn't respond or weren't asked.
Yeah.
All right.
Polls aren't exactly the most accurate gauge of anything. When you consider that a response rate is typically only going to be about 15%.
The reason that Adam Silver said is that we wouldn't be able to conduct business properly in this state. But this All-Star game, how does that, you taking it out and it being there, what is that? That does not harm business.
It does.
How does that harm business?
Thousands of dollars.
No, I'm talking about leaving it there. What does that law have to do with anything, anyone coming to the game or watching
trans
it?
People won't come to the game.
They wouldn't. You wouldn't come to the game because of what?
Because they're uncomfortable with the bathroom situation. It wouldn't scare all of them away, but it'd scare enough of them away.
Yeah.
If you can squeeze every dollar you can out of a thing, you're going to do whatever you can to get as much money as possible.
Keep in mind, Mark, we're talking about a subset of people that for the last few decades, and probably even longer than that, we just haven't noticed, have been people who, you know, those kids who like don't go to public bathrooms for whatever reason
because they're disgusting.
Well, there's that, but I mean, like, also go to bathrooms at your school, bathrooms at your work.
Disgusting.
Well, yes.
I try not to go, yeah.
But imagine it being like that, but then being it because you don't feel comfortable in your own skin going somewhere, being forced to go somewhere that honestly isn't what you identify as.
It's not even about the money at this point, it's just the principle of the thing. They disagree with forcing people to do what they aren't comfortable doing. That's why the NBA pulled out.
All right,
Especially when the reasoning behind forcing them to do it is pretty weak.
What's the reason?
Trans people are rapists, probably.
That's what some
people have said.
That's what the majority of them are.
I'm uncomfortable with this born woman going to the men's bathroom because she's going to rape me. It's like, well, I mean, she might, but probably not. There's a small chance one of them is a rapist, but not enough to legally forbid anything.
If
they're gonna rape you, they're gonna rape you regardless of what bathroom they're legally allowed to go to.
Yeah. Well,
laws
and,
don't stop and, rapists.
And
you
not
would
to
know.
Mention, it's funny because it's coming from the conservative movement that for so long has been like laughing off rape culture as being nothing but just a nothing but a passing thing.
Boys will be boys.
Just.
Well, I mean, this just adds to the thing that conservative people, for the most part, they're just a bunch of hateful bigots in my eyes.
Speaking of people's genitalia, hashtag dicks out for Harambe.
What was that?
Why
do
you
that?
Have to make that shout out? Now,
what is
now
that?
That's going to be in my dreams again.
What is that?
So,
oh, God.
You know Harambe, the gorilla that was shot for dragging a kid around?
Yeah.
Well, people have been like,
we're
going to
get so much flack.
We can't make fun of like real people that died, so we're going to put those down.
Why can't we?
Because it's rude. So we can make fun of a gorilla that died, because that's not rude, apparently.
I mean,
and
that,
so they're like, okay.
Peter would say otherwise.
Hmm?
Peter would say otherwise.
Yeah, well, I would also say otherwise. It's still just generally offensive.
Peter also kills thousands of animals that it rescues.
Yeah, it does. Too soon. So anyway, people were like, this gorilla that died. How do you show respect for people? Oh, you just whip your genitalia out? Is that a respectful thing to do? Yeah, it's respectful. Okay, let's not do that. Dicks out for Harambe.
Well,
there's really no thought put into it, probably.
That's not very funny. It's not because it's offensive. It's just not a funny joke. That contributed nothing, Sam. You're wasting my gray matter. Anyway.
It would help if you would, say something.
I have an episode title.
No.
Sorry, who's in charge of our plugs here?
Oh boy.
I mean, I will edit it.
Taking command.
As long as it's like that for the first hour.
Well,
I'm kidding. I won't do that. I would never do that without you.
All right. So what else do we want to talk about?
Heroin.
Now, what about you? I ever did a drug before?
I mean, allergy medication.
Stop being stupid. You know what I mean. I knew you was going to say that.
Vyvanse.
I got like 6 shots in my ass when I was getting ready to go to training.
Hot. For what?
When I was getting ready to go to basic training last summer at Fort Leonard Wood.
What's your language?
Basically, they like shuffle you into a little room with a bunch of people. You have to go single file line. And they're like, all right, up against the wall. Have you turn around, you have to like lower your pants so that just the upper area of your butt cheeks.
So you can get a shot in your rear.
Yep, and they come by and they just stick it in you nice and quick.
Well, what is that for?
It was just different immunizations. Yeah, because a lot of the people going into training, like a lot of us were just kids who hadn't really been out doing this kind of stuff before.
Hmm.
Hadn't been out away from home this long.
Speaking of hot, that lady at the shoe store still got her number.
All right, we got a quiz rut for you. It's about Dark Souls, Sam.
Ooh.
You play that game.
Ooh, we're doing trivia already?
Already, yes. It's been like 30 minutes, I think.
Yeah, like 35, 38.
So, did you study? How long?
Yeah, I mean, I played the games. I read the text in the games.
All right, well.
It's about as much studying as I could do.
Should I quiz you as well, or?
Sure. My friends are more up on the
You're not
than
getting
I am,
anything from this,
so. I don't care.
Alright, so, question number one.
Who goes first, you or me?
You just blur out the answer.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Go for it.
Dark Souls is a spiritual successor to what?
Demon Souls!
Oh, wait, it's not gonna work if... Alright, you're right. Is that what you're gonna say?
Yeah.
Alright, I'll take your word
for it. So we're gonna do buzzer kind of thing? We're gonna race for it?
No, it's the honor system. You say something and I hope the other person said whatever they're gonna say, honestly. So number two. What was Dark Souls 1?
Write it down.
Write what down?
The answer.
No, just keep track of it.
Okay. All
right, you got 1 point.
Yeah.
You got 1 point. I hope you earned that point. What was Dark Souls 1 development name?
Demon
Dick
Souls 2?
Project Dark. You're both wrong.
Oh, okay.
What is the basic plot of Dark Souls 1?
You're saving the world from fire.
No, you get the choice.
Oh.
You have to go around and collect the Lord Vessel by collecting the souls of the various lords of the old world. And then you have to decide whether or not you will rekindle the flame in order to allow the Age of Light to continue, or let it die out and let the Age of Darkness come in.
Where is this flame?
Lord Gwyn.
And Orlando.
Oh, no.
You know what? I didn't write that, so I think both of y'all got the basic plot, I guess. Y'all get a point. I put an undead character making a pilgrimage to the undead asylum. Is that
you don't make it to the yeah from
from? All right.
Well, that's just part of like the old poem in the beginning of the game. A pilgrimage from the undead asylum to.
So it doesn't really matter. I mean, he's technically right. You are leaving the undead asylum.
Yeah,
and you are undead.
I like how the Wikipedia entry for this game, it says it's a minimalist plot, but they wrote 10 paragraphs about it.
Well, it's minimalist because the game doesn't reveal the plot to you.
You know what else is
the
minimalist?
Plot's just interwoven.
We get it. You have 2 inches of Sam down there. We get
Whoa.
It.
But no. Whoa. But like, what makes the game so good is that it's like you go through the game and you go through, you fight your enemies, and you experience like a very what on the surface appears to be a pretty light story.
Let's move on.
But then, as you read into the lore, as you meet different characters, and as you like actually explore. You learn more. So, like, that story that they had 10 paragraphs of, the game doesn't tell you that. You have to find it.
Yeah, okay.
No, that makes this game good.
Moving on.
Number 4, Dark Souls 2 was released on... At what show in 2012?
E3.
I'm wrong.
NerdCon.
Wrong.
Nintendo's...
Stop! Alright, it was revealed on my birthday, December 7th, at the Spike Video Game Awards.
Spike? I forgot that still exists.
Spike VGA.
Yeah, I remember a great channel had A Thousand Way to Die and Mancers. Great show.
And Deadliest Warrior.
Whatever.
Yeah, you know, back before it became trash.
Name a game from Software developed that isn't Dark Souls, Bloodborne, or Demon's
Armored
Souls.
Armored Core.
Armored Core 4 answer.
Alright, that's right, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, it is, right?
Yeah, it is, because we have it.
Alright, you got 3 points.
And by we, I mean me.
My system.
Number 6, Demon and Dark Souls were successors to what? Demon Souls and Dark Souls.
I don't know.
Mario 64.
Okay, you're both wrong. It was Kingsfield.
Shot.
What's Kingsfield? Hold on.
It's a game. Look it up on your own time.
I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't like get too into it. We just say right or
wrong. I usually do get. I try to get into it, but I don't know anything about Dark Souls. I'm not interested. Number 7. What
Mark's bad at it.
What were the scrap names for Dark Souls?
Or the what?
The scrap names.
No idea.
Demon Souls 2.
No.
Demon Souls, the Demon Souling.
No, you're wrong.
The Demoning.
It was going to be called the Dark Ring, but a Dark Ring could be taken as a euphemism for anus. And then the second name that they're going to have was the Dark Race, and you could...
Yeah, that's pretty racist.
Doesn't have to be. A racist mind is a racist kind. Now you take that to bed with you tonight.
I mean, everybody's a little bit racist.
Everyone's a little bit racist.
Number 8. What is the trick to defeating the ancient wyvern boss?
Shoot its tail off.
No. That doesn't...
The wyvern?
That's not how you end up beating people. That's just how you get items. Wait, the wyvern boss is Dark Souls, correct?
I don't know. It's the ancient wyvern boss.
Just snipe it from afar.
It's the plunging attack. I don't know what that means.
Oh, it's where you like jump from the top.
Yeah, you have to jump from somewhere and land on it.
There you go. Number 9. Which Dark
Souls was making a very, very.
I was not
thrusting.
Which was the dark? Which Dark Souls was held the highest by critics?
Dark Souls, the first one.
Demon Souls.
Dark Souls 3. And
what? Oh, well, then again, I haven't played it yet.
Which Dark Souls sold the most?
Demon Souls.
Dark Souls 1, you're correct.
Ding, ding, ding. You suck.
And then we got a bonus. Is Dark Souls series overrated?
Subjectively, no. But Mark is saying yes, so yes.
And I'm going to say no. Fuck you. It's great.
So, 4-4.
Alright. Well, that's that. You got like 6 points.
Why do you think it's overrated?
I don't know. I played it one time and I didn't like it. Didn't feel.
You died.
What do you mean? I don't know.
Instantly.
I mean, I played it once and I didn't like it.
He thinks it's overrated. Overrated is subjective. So yeah.
Overrated because he played it one time and didn't like it.
Yeah.
Will, it's subjective.
Fair. Yeah, it is. I know.
I feel like most reviewers only played it one time as well.
What the fuck? All right.
And I got 5 things to look forward to make your dark life a little bit brighter. Something to look forward to.
And your dark rain.
Maybe tomorrow I'll bring out the knife, but not today. Tomorrow I might cut myself, but not today. I can hold it out. I got something to look forward to.
What?
Like Azure Striker or Gunbolt too.
That sounds like a game that exists.
It is a game that exists and it's coming out pretty soon.
Yeah, what's it like?
It kind of reminds me of Mega Man. It's a Mega Man type game, but
ew. We hate Mega Man.
Yeah, I do hate Mega Man, but but it looks more fun because it has like different type of weapons.
So does Mega Man.
Mega Man.
No. Oh my god! Can I finish the sentence around here?
No.
They got different type of weapons from Mega Man that they seem interesting to me.
Okay.
Like what?
I don't know. I saw like a guy shoot electricity from the sky.
Ooh.
That looked pretty cool.
I'm fairly certain you get that in Mega Man.
Like no, doesn't matter.
What Mega Man game is that?
Yeah, Will. What Mega Man boss do you get it from?
I don't know. Probably freaking Power Plug Man from Mega Man X7. I don't know.
There's no X7.
Like yeah, there is an X7. I'm pretty sure. The last one was X8. I'm pretty sure.
I have no idea. I've never played Mega Man before.
Let's look at. No, let's look. Y'all looking for that God of War? Speaking of soft reboots.
Oh yeah. Oh, so soft. I can't wait for this new Norse. Stop throwing things. This new Norse God of War. Looks pretty fun. It's like an escort quest because you have your son all of the time.
Oh wow! All
right.
And the world loves escort missions.
Is the ending gonna be like Red Dead Redemption, where then you have to play as the son?
Oh, I didn't play that yet. Stop spoiling it.
The game's been out for how many years now?
That doesn't mean I played it.
Yeah, well, you only spoil like 50-year-old things. Okay.
You got
like, the ending to Pong. Is
stop! Haven't got to it yet. All right.
You know, for a guy who likes to complain about overrated games, you don't even play the classics.
That's not a classic. It's only been out for like 5-10 years.
I'm talking about Pong.
Pong's not a classic. It sucks.
It's great.
Now, Pong fan fiction, on the other hand.
All right, we're looking forward to that U.S. president election day.
I got you.
Y'all looking forward to election day?
Yeah, I'm voting nobody because I can't vote.
You could vote, right?
No.
Being a service member and already kind of extrapolating upon that in this podcast, I'd rather not get too deep into my political leanings for this election.
Why?
Who you gonna vote for?
Because
Harambe.
Because it would probably... Part of me feels like it would be a little bit inappropriate.
How?
That being said, given...
All you
given,
need to do is
given
say
all
who
my
you're
arguments
voting for.
Previously in this podcast, I get the feeling that people are already gonna know.
Just say who you're voting for.
Well, how's it inappropriate to talk about the future status of our nation?
Especially who's going to be ordering you around as your commander-in-chief.
This is the most relevant topic as a U.S. citizen that there ever is and there ever going to be. So I think this is the one thing. If you're going to talk about anything, this is going to be it.
All right. At this point, I'm considering voting for Clinton. All
Bill? Right.
What? No, I'm talking about Obama Clinton.
Chelsea Clinton?
No, definitely not.
Hmm. All right, there's nothing wrong with that. It's perfectly fine.
Can President Obama just have like a third term?
No.
I'd be okay with
that.
Yeah,
he pull a Roosevelt on us? Have like two more terms?
Not because...
Nah, 22nd Amendment. It's going to keep him out of it.
He's got months to get that repealed.
Why have that? Because if you're going to vote for the president multiple times, that means he's really good or the other one's really bad.
You don't want a dictator.
But he still has checks and balances. He's not going to be a dictator. Instead of some other guy that's not as good as this guy. He's going
to be term limits for Congress.
Yeah,
senators, all that.
Oh, that's going to be a fun debate. I could definitely get in with y'all on.
Donald Trump needs to have term limits.
Wait, they don't have. Oh yeah, they don't have term limits, do they?
No, they don't.
Why don't they? Because
you get career politicians that are like, I represent my district, from 50 years ago.
Also,
our last lynching was like. Yesterday,
but the thing is, also, Congress is the one who sets those rules. Congress isn't going to limit itself. You can't. It's really hard to tell people.
You got career politicians with their own butt mold in their seats.
Okay, you can't use career politicians as your scapegoat for everything wrong.
No, I'm not saying. I'm just saying, like, you have ones that have been there so long, they have butt molds in their seats.
Oh yeah.
I don't like that career politician. Like. In my eyes, the way I view it as a child, I would. Like, you would go to college, you might be a doctor, and maybe you might become a mayor because, you know, I'm a high-standing citizen in my community.
Ben Carson's a doctor.
And then you go on, you move up the ranks, and eventually...
He is.
Eventually become a congressmember or even a president because You don't, in my eyes, you wouldn't train to become a president. You'd be like, I'm such a well-versed person, and I'm qualified to be a president, so I'll become one.
Except, here's the thing, no one's qualified to be president.
No. I'm not talking about, like, the qualifications, like, objectively. I'm talking about, like, I'm a well-versed person, and I'm going to give my time, this part of my life, to this country.
So you think the common man?
Yeah, like, just a well-versed, regular person could just go in there.
Ben Carson?
I mean, yeah, I'm not talking about anyone in particular, but I'm talking about, like, no, there shouldn't be, like, anyone doing this for, like, their whole lives, because you only have so much to contribute, I think.
Yeah, but at the same time, do you want a guy who doesn't know, like, I don't know, say, the members of NATO? Ben Carson, Donald Trump.
Well, like, don't even... Now, let's not call anyone out.
No, I will call him out. Because on the one hand, I totally agree with you that with the sentiment where we need people who genuinely are just, like, good people who want to do good things for our country. But at the same time, you can't just say, like, I don't want career politicians. It's like, because those are your most experienced guys. Those are going to be the guys who know that Putin likes his coffee a certain way, and so maybe you mess that up when he comes to visit the White House or something. Or you deal with people who know the intricacies of the committee process, people who know all of our allies and their quirks and how to work with them. Like, you can't just say, I want to have a regular guy go in and do it, when we live in an age where you need to have a guy who has some experience dealing with more than just tending to matters at home.
Why does politics gotta be so sad? I can never get any better than what it is, because it's the best it can be.
Time for anarchy.
No.
No.
Dylan born to lead, am I right, guys?
Get out of here. Anyway. Anyway, I think I feel a little bit worse from talking about that. But another thing to look forward to is Pokemon Sun and Moon.
Mark, stop putting it in the docket.
I mean, this is my driving force in my life. Like, if you open up my chest, you see Pokemon Sun and Moon just pumping the blood.
I listen to all of your podcasts by now, and I'm fairly certain you've mentioned.
Well, it's just something. A running joke.
I know.
It's not a joke.
I'm trying to play along.
No, you're not. Yes, I am.
Oh my god! The game of the week this week, which you could probably tell with the first 19 minutes of gameplay, is Donkey Kong Country for the SNES. You should
Is that gonna give you guys another editing strike with Nintendo?
Yeah, we need to stop uploading Nintendo.
No! You don't have to stop. See how it works is you sign up for the creators program.
You mean the one that copyright strike? Struck us and
no,
didn't take it down?
It's not verified yet. You see, once our channel gets verified, this won't be a problem. And I'm still learning how this works, but I know that we could do whatever we want once we get verified. And it's taking a long time. It takes about 3 days. It's like day three, so it should be verified anytime now. I'm just gonna wait until then. There's no need to rush, and there's no need to panic, because eventually everything will be fine. Because if that was the case, no one would be uploading Nintendo videos, because everyone would have copyright strikes.
Nobody does upload Nintendo.
Well, that's just false. All right. Anyway, you could get Donkey Kong Country on the virtual console, or you could download it illegally or order it off Amazon for your old SNES system. It's a pretty unique platform. It's kind of harder than Mario, like, overall from the beginning. But it's pretty fun.
Shout out to our two new subscribers.
Now screw them. Anyway, you played Donkey Kong before?
Great way to cultivate that image.
Donkey
there,
Kong,
Mark.
Which one?
Country, the one I was just talking about.
Yeah, is that the one that was released on the Game Boy? Yes.
What?
Yeah, Donkey Kong Country. That was a Game Boy game, right? That was a Game Boy.
There was a Game Boy Advance port like 10 years later. I'm talking about the one on SNES where you play as Donkey and Diddy Kong.
No.
Alright.
I don't have an SNES.
You have emulators, you have an internet.
I don't have a SNES emulator.
Do the Donkey Kong rap? Can we do that to, like, see us?
No, we cannot.
There was a Game Boy Color emulator or port of that.
Yeah,
Game Boy.
I had that as a kid.
That's what we had. I remember that level distinctly.
Oh, that's the first level.
Exactly. I was always stuck there because 12-year-olds can't, or 2-year-olds can't play.
I was always there just farming for lives, and then I would eventually go and fail at every other level in the game.
Farming for lives is how he says I sucked at the game and didn't want to leave my comfort zone.
I literally just said I went to every other level and died.
I mean, the game is pretty hard, like I said, especially the second world. Because you got those, you have to, like, drive on minecarts and jump.
Oh, those were fun.
Yeah.
Ugh. I mean, if you watch the recording later on, I got a game over. That's pretty hard. Anyway, before we go, y'all want to talk about any games or stuff you've been reading, playing, watching?
I'm kind of interested to see how the rest of the Watchmen universe kind of plays into DC with Rebirth.
Okay. Well,
I'm just saying.
Would you say that you're more of a comic book guy than a video game guy?
Honestly,
you cannot say that.
I don't know. Sam's more of a comic book person than me, and then like all of my friends are more anime and video game nerdy than me because I'm busy doing a lot of stuff for ROTC, National Guard, and school.
Busy. So,
yeah, like catching up on sleep after waking up at 4 a.m.
Don't need it.
Sleep is for the weak. You know who dies in their sleep?
People who sleep.
Exactly. You can't die in your sleep if you don't sleep.
Fair. But in any event, I don't know. I'm a jack of all trades, master of none. So if there's something that I like about comic books or video games, I'll definitely fiddle around with it and get knowledgeable, like Watchmen. But other than that, I can't tell you much.
You'll twiddle his fiddle around with it.
Yep.
All right.
I diddle my fiddles.
So what are you looking forward to in terms of games?
Honestly, I'm just
fine with what I have.
I mean, I'm waiting for there's this old strategy game series called Blitzkrieg that I used to love to play as a kid, and there's a new version of, there's Blitzkrieg 3 on Steam, which it looks great, but
that's that RTS, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
But I'm waiting for them to balance out a lot of the units and everything, and for it to go on sale before I buy it. I literally just yesterday I bought Subnautica, an early access game. That
game was pretty.
It definitely is not the type of game I would generally play.
Well, what is it?
It's like a survival exploration game.
But it's like you're basically stranded on. Does it have a crafting system? Is that the one
that's
crafting?
Yeah, you have a crafting system. You're stranded.
Like
why are you rolling your eyes?
That game, like all the. I'm not saying it's made for YouTube, but that's what all the YouTubers play, is those exploration, like, survival games. I bet the game's not bad.
It's like No Man's Sky, but for islands.
Yeah, because you get...
Segway, No Man's Sky, great game. Can't wait to get it.
I actually haven't seen any gameplay for that.
There's no need. That game is going to be nothing. It's going to come and go. It's going to come and go, and it's not going to be anything.
Okay, well, that's just wrong.
I mean...
It's, like, the biggest game of all time.
Yeah. What are you talking about?
It's like objectively has the largest game.
Oh, because it can randomly generate infinite amount of worlds. Who cares?
I care.
It can randomly generate into infinity. Oh my god, such a lackluster feat.
I'm not saying it's like a lackluster feat. Oh, that's cool, but I'm not interested. Like, what does the game have to offer?
Because
whenever
fly around, you get to discover worlds, you get to name species as you discover them. You get to name planets as you discover them.
Oh,
you're asking what it has to offer. It literally has to offer infinite numbers of universes you can explore.
It's also got combat. Space and land. Although, since it's so big, you're probably not going to be meeting a lot of people.
But I just want to know, what's the depth of the gameplay? You can have all that, like, nice pretty stuff, all those numbers, but what can I actually do?
You can explore and shoot and kill and hunt and be a scientist.
But
if you feel like
what's
it.
The depth? Do I get like?
Exploration,
do I get upgrades?
Survival, combat, and trading.
But
that's
what?
Pretty in depth.
I mean, no. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking like, are certain weapons better than others? Is there a level up system?
Probably.
Is there a complex combat system?
I don't know how complex you want this to be.
Will there be parrying?
Probably not.
Probably. Who knows? It's got guns. You can't parry with guns.
You parry with weapons. I mean, so they're not going to be any sticks? No swords?
Probably
not. So it's going to be guns?
It's a space game, dude. You just walk around like, I got my space.
But there's planets, and planets have wood.
Got my gas-powered stick.
Depending on what the planet is, they wouldn't be any material to make a gun, but there would only be material to make, like, spears.
You already have a gun.
You're flying around in a spaceship.
Mark.
What makes you think that the guy's going to be going all Rambo?
Mark.
Why would we thinking that you was born on a planet and your whole village was dead.
Where'd you get the spaceship?
Well, I didn't know that. That's what I'm explaining. Like, I don't know. Whatever.
I'm sorry.
This game's whatever. I'm not getting this game.
Just gotta look into it. All I know is I'm hyped for it. David's hyped for it. Henry better be hyped for it. Basically, the 4A squad. You know the 4A squad.
Oh,
explains.
We were hyped for that.
Explain to the audience the 4A squad.
The 4A squad. So it's fourth period on A days in high school last year. We were in a cafeteria study hall. It was me and like 3 to 5 to 6 of my closest friends.
Men, real men.
And
paragons of men.
And a gender fluid team. Anyway, we were all just so hyped for this game. At least 3 of us were. We were just so hyped for everything about this game. It's everything like we've wanted. And we are the best of friends. Actually, Henry was in the 4A squad, the one that you heard earlier.
That guy's a man.
He's repping the 4A squad.
So anyway, I'm going to go back to playing my RPGs. I'm going to be happy. I don't like to call anything lame, but that's pretty...
You called literally everything lame today.
I don't get how you can... How it would be... Nah, never mind.
What? Just go ahead.
Well, how is it lame? I mean, maybe not your taste.
Well, I mean,
games,
I'm not. I don't
how's
mean.
How's it lame?
Because we aren't really explaining it. We're
I don't.
Giving it full justice.
I mean, I'm not mean. It's lame. That's a joke. But I'm just not interested in the game.
It's right. Very ableist of you to say lame.
What does that mean? Does that mean
it's
my brother's gonna come kill me?
What?
You said ableist.
Yeah.
Able. What does that mean?
Oh, it's just like, you know, you're making fun of people with disabilities. It was a
by
joke.
Saying that something
I was wrong. Poking fun at the PC culture we live in today, where you can't say anything without it being...
I mean, that's just the culture. You can't say anything about anyone without catching something, boy.
Oh, he said catching. That's receiverist.
I guess.
I don't know.
Golden retrieverist.
You can't complain too much about PC culture, though.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, you can. I think
you and I literally just spent, like, about 15 minutes of this podcast defending trans people and our argument against... Our argument for the NBA being against a trans bathroom law.
We can poke fun at parts of PC culture.
I wasn't arguing against trans people. I was arguing against the NBA being selective.
Yeah, we were arguing for the NBA's choice. That's what I was getting at.
I was saying we can poke fun at the PC culture that makes everything impossible.
No. I think we should be able to poke fun at everyone. Because everyone's hilarious in their own ways and everyone's stupid in their own ways.
Just, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Within reason, everything should be fair game.
Yeah.
No, within reason.
I gotta get ready to head out.
Oh, okay. You leaving?
Yep.
Where you going? Blow up stuff?
Nope. I wish. No, I have to pay bills, and I have to get ready to move.
Gotta pay those automobiles.
Alright, turn it off. Turn it off now.
What?